a French guy, and normally I realize some video about the tech product, but today I'm with you, Seb.
With the car.
With this baby.
With the baby. No, Romain is one of my best friends in the world, and we've been mates since we went to school together, and we both got into the YouTube game around the same time, and we actually rekindled our friendship through YouTube. So it's awesome now being back together. So he usually does tech reviews in French, but today he's brought a car lent by Ford, Ford France. It is a Mustang Bullitt. Super, super cool car, super rare. So I wanted to share it with you guys, and Romain's very kindly gonna let us have a little go. So this thing is an homage towards Steve McQueen's car in the film Bullitt, which was around 50 years ago. And it's a car that's completely made to kind of commemorate Steve McQueen and that movie. So it's finished in the exact same spec, down to the little details, such as there being no logos. So there were no logos in the car in the film, purely because Ford weren't prepared to pay to have a product placement in the movie. So Steve McQueen said, just take their logos off if they're not gonna pay, have the car in it anyways. And they've even stayed true to themselves on that and removed the logos from this one. The only place you can see the logo is on the wheels. It's pretty cool. He's put the sunglasses on, now things are serious.
On, off.
Yeah. And then we got the Bullitt logo back here. So it's an absolutely stunning spec. So it's in this dark olive green. I'm not sure if it comes across on camera properly, but
like
really,
the,
really
like,
nice.
The last iPhone.
Like the last iPhone. Yeah, that's very true. Actually, like the one I'm filming on right now. It's like that dark olive green, iPhone green. And then it's got translucent white lights here at the back. It's got those classic looking alloys, which really commemorate the old car. It's got a slightly extended front splitter, which is finished in plastic, not carbon, just purely because it's more convenient, and also price-wise, we'll talk about that in a second. It's got a few touches. Most things are blacked out, such as the grill, but there are a few chrome touches, like I'll show you around. We've got these grills here blacked out, which are purely aesthetic. They don't actually serve a purpose. They don't go anywhere, but they look cool. We've got the red calipers attached to some Brembo steel brakes, massive calipers. No carbon ceramics available on this one. We're running Michelin Pilot Sport 4S's, and absolutely stunning. Now the chrome comes across again around the windows, and I think that's a really, really nice touch. They've done it really well. Now, what makes this car cool, obviously, is the engine, and we'll talk about that when we get inside, but is also the practicality of this car.
Yeah.
Because we've got an actual boot in which we've put my ride, which I ride around in Monaco, because driving around Monaco in summer is a nightmare. So I ride this electric scooter around. But look at the size of this boot. For a car which punches out 464 horsepower, that is an impressive sized boot. And not only do you have a boot, you've also got, if I open it up here, you have two real back seats. Now, to demonstrate this, I'm going to ask Romain to hop into the back of the car. Oops, there we go. Now you need to just pull the seat back, and there we go, he's in. Oh, someone wants to drive. Sorry, I'm just going to lock you in. But as you can tell, you can fit a guy. I think he's 1.80 meters odd. How tall are you? 1 meter?
1.86 meters.
1.86 meters, yeah. So yeah, nearly 1.90 meters. So that's what, like 6'1", 6 foot? Yeah, around 6 foot, something like that. So also, such a pain. You need two people to do this. Ready? There we go. So you can use that either to put bags, or if you have, you know, friends that you need to take back from a dinner. It's not a long-term rear seat, but it is a good spot to have in case you need to help your friends out and take them back from a dinner or something. Now, if we get inside, now Mustangs traditionally have been known to have, you know, not the sweetest looking interiors and the modern ones. It's kind of where they were let down, because obviously the price point of this car, this one with options, you're talking around 60,000 euros for effectively a top of the line Mustang. Now you can tell you've also got the Bullitt logo here rather than the Mustang logo. Now, so 60,000 euros, they're going to be cut somewhere compared to like S-Class coupes or different four-seater coupes of this type. But I think in this generation, they've really, really nailed it. So you've got a mix of leather and plastic, but really nicely kind of put together. And then you've got this kind of aluminium finish around the air vents, which is really nice and kind of goes with the whole Bullitt aspect. See the logo right there. Really nicely put together. Now, the important things to remember is we have a naturally aspirated V8, just under 500 horsepower, 464 to be precise, linked to a manual 6-speed gearbox. This car is not available in anything other than manual. which means it's a real driver's car. And you've even got a traditional handbrake. So proper car. You got the three pedals down here, which are pretty well distanced. A little far away, but you know, you can still do a bit of heel and toe. And a lot of technology. So whilst it is traditional, they've mixed that traditional side of things with the modern touch so nicely. So whilst you've got that Brunty V8, you've got the manual, you've also got a fully digital dash, for example. Now to do that, foot on the clutch, foot on the brake, that green button lights up on the start button right there. And then, it starts up. It struggled a bit there. I think it's because the battery in the car has been on.
Oh, yeah, or it's because just before you put...
Oh, yeah, we did some revs. Yeah, I'm not going to do too many revs. You'll hear it when we drive it. But, no, this thing is awesome.
I can take it if you want.
Oh, yeah, you want to do it?
To do the same.
Okay, just a few.
Yeah. Lovely.
It sounds so good. I mean, that is literally the American national anthem coming out the rear end of this thing. Now, let's talk about this digital dash, because you do have a lot of options. So, you got these buttons right here, and then you got a magical button here, little horse, and then you can go through all your different modes. So, for example, here, you can change, it's all in French, but I don't know if you could hear the difference, but the exhaust completely shut down there. You can put it back in normal, sport, or track mode for the car, and that kind of, you know, sharpens it up, manages the traction control and different things like that. You've got your cruise control through here, your nav, and loads of different, your volume, and then this is your voice control, voice command, and to go through the different menus that you have in that central part of the digital dash. So really nice, 56 kilometers an hour, yeah. Average speed. You're loving life, aren't you? Look at you. And then what else do we have? So again, everything can be controlled through screen. So this is about them combining modern and old school. Everything can be done through screen. So as you saw with the traction control systems, or you've got traditional buttons. So you can choose how you want it. For example, even for the AC, you can either do it through the screen here, or you've got the actual button. So they've really nicely kind of judged how to make this car modern whilst also keeping it for the true kind of petrol heads who really want to be able to see, you know, like the new Panameras or things like that. Sometimes I feel they're too much focused on buttons. You need to go through too many menus to be able to find what you want, whereas I actually prefer it when it's more analog like this. You've got heated and cooled seats, which is lovely on a hot day like today. It's 25 degrees. It's actually not as much as I expected. So lovely to be able to have that. And then just the little details like the white gear shifter. Super, super nice. So, absolutely lovely interior. Even better looking exterior. And but such a cool story. Oh, yes.
She's connected.
Yeah, the car is connected to an app. So it's, the technology is nuts.
Yeah, to know where is my car in the real time.
That's insane.
Yeah.
So you can see, you can also see your fuel, yep. How much fuel you have left, your tire pressures, your odometer. Oh, it's only got 1,800 kilometers, about 1,000 miles.
Yeah.
Oil life, everything.
You have a classical car with the latest
technology. Yeah, that is epic. Yeah, and they've done it well. They've judged, that's a fine line to walk, I feel. And a lot of brands maybe don't walk it quite as well, where you're trying to combine historical kind of aspects to the car whilst also giving it that modern touch. And I feel like they've done it pretty well. Romain, shall we drive?
Let's go.
Let's do it. Can I drive?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. All right, let's give this thing a go. All the way up to 7,000 RPM. Oh, yes, America. Oh, it's like accelerating in this thing is like you've eaten a whole burger in one bite. It's unbelievable. That noise. As I said earlier, that is the American national anthem. There is nothing which makes me think of America more than a green bullet Mustang shouting in the way this thing does. Now, very interesting driving experience, because it's a Mustang and you can tell it was mainly developed for those big, straight American roads, which is fine. I mean, now we're on like a dual carriageway and it feels fantastic, but it is quite big and you can feel that there is a certain weight to it. We've got our, all the warnings coming up because this car is really technologically advanced. It gets a lot of looks as well. Everyone's staring to see what it is. And you described it well. This isn't the kind of car which shows like, oh yes, I'm I'm like here to show you how much, you know, money I have, or it's not really a show-offy car. When you drive this around, people kind of respect you and they're like, yes, you know what you're doing, you know what you're talking about, and you're driving a cool car. Because a Mustang Bullitt, there's something so glamorous and cool and kind of badass about it. Oh, the brakes are lovely, these steel brakes on the road. I mean, steel brakes, there's no real need for the carbon ceramics unless you're really going to be thrashing it. And they've got such good feel, these brakes, that they're really communicative, and the pedal is really nicely placed close to the accelerator. The steering, I am in sport mode now, so it weightens itself up a little bit more. But for my liking, it's still a little bit too light, these modern electric steerings, but still very nice. I mean, it doesn't take too much away from the experience. What is so cool is through this shifter, short throw shifter like this, with the pedals placed good for some heel and toe, it's lovely. Really, really old school. It's just got such like a, well, a bullish feeling to it.
Yeah.
I don't know what you were gonna say there, but no, it is. Oh, it's so cool. Look, you go down. Short throw gearbox really does make a difference. And that noise, I hope it comes across on camera enough, but it just sounds so good. And you can get to a chaff glide like this. Oh, it's just so badass. Now, what they've done quite well is this digital dashboard. So you've got all the advantages of a digital dashboard, of having all these different informations when you need them in front of you. Yet they've done it in a way which it still looks fairly analog. Really well done. I really feel that the thing they've nailed the most with this line, with this car, is walking that line of keeping the history, keeping the story behind it, whilst having it adequately modernized. They've done that really, really well. Now, a few things is it is very big, because it was mainly developed for those American roads. It does feel big, it does feel heavy when you're going around the corners, and it feels, it's a badass bad boy car. So it feels like the back end kind of wants to come and bite your head off whenever you put your foot down a bit. But that's kind of cool, I quite like that. But you know, it's no track day kind of car. It's more cruise along, PCH yeah. in LA, and enjoy yourself.
And for me, it's not possible to buy a car like a Ford Mustang.
Yeah.
If you don't have a Ford Mustang, it's not possible to.
There's nothing quite like it. You were saying earlier,
it's like
AMGs.
Ferrari.
AMGs make that kind of badass muscle car noise. But there's something about it being linked with the Mustang where you go, this is it. This is the real deal.
I have the history with me.
Exactly. I'm driving a piece of automotive history. And as you said, it's kind of like a Ferrari. Nothing will quite give you the feel of a Ferrari, because a Ferrari is the real deal. And you know, as much as you can hate on Ferrari, and a lot of people do, and Ferrari as a company have made many stupid mistakes, and there's so many negative sides to them, but yet it's Ferrari and it's so special. Now Mustang, it's Mustang, and you're driving something which is irreplaceable, and no matter how much people try and replicate it, they'll always be the real deal, and there'll always be cars which aren't quite that. And this is the ultimate entity, kind of incorporating that into its DNA. And they've done such a good job with it. And finally, I feel the interior is up to date, and the interior is kind of following the history, the character, and the looks of the car on the outside. Now they finally put it with an interior which kind of matches up to those things. So they've really, really done a good job with this. It's a shame it's so rare, but that's what makes it special as well. So no, they've done it really, really well. I was actually there at the launch of this car, and this is the first time I get to drive one. And it is true that, I mean, but the Bullitt, I mean, if you're going to drive any Mustang, I think this is probably the coolest
one. For sure.
Like, I'm sure the Shelby 350s and stuff are probably slightly more, you know, raw, but this is the coolest one.
I have drive a GT 4050. It's incredible. Like a dragster.
The more powerful versions of this are unreal. But there's just something about Steve McQueen and this car, and the story behind it, with it being from the film, which makes it, it's so cool. You can drive a modern Aston and it'll be better in every way than an old one like a DB5, but you're still just so much cooler in the DB5. That's kind of, there's a side of that with this car. But yeah, it is awesome. Right, we're gonna get into town, and because this car is quite big, I'm gonna put the cameras off, focus on driving there. But thank you, Hormel, for letting me drive this car. Really, really cool. And we're gonna arrive at the port, because there should be a pretty cool boat that I want to show you guys as well. cool. For the outro of this. Well, it fits in very, very nicely here, right next to this. So I was hoping we could actually go all the way over there, but they've closed it down.
Like this, you can put in this box.
You could put a lot of these in there, and I think that costs, I think it was $500 million. So you could buy a lot of Mustangs for the price of that. But it is the biggest privately owned yacht by gross tonnage and interior space in the world. It's pretty nuts. But thank you for letting me drive this. Thank you Ford France as well for insuring it so that I could drive it. And it's been pretty awesome. Romain, thank you so much. If you guys speak French and you want to learn about tech, his channel is going to be down below, and his Instagram is not awesome.